Welcome to the Goods from the Woods. My name is Rivers Langley.
I'm Sam Harder.
And I'm Carter Glasscock.
And today we are so pleased to be joined by a comedian and guy who's got a brand new special called Conditional Love on YouTube right now. It's our friend
Stuart Thompson.
Welcome back to the damn show, Stu. Welcome. How are you doing?
I'm grateful to be back. I'm very well.
Yeah, hell yeah. Well, talk to us a little bit about the special. I know you taped it at the Punchline in San Francisco.
Yeah, it's one of the first clubs that took a chance on me. I started my comedy career in San Francisco, and I wanted to do it in a place that meant something to me. You know, I've seen a lot of specials where, for whatever reason, it feels kind of like a place where it's not clear where it is. It could happen anywhere. And if that's the goal, then I totally get that. But I wanted a place that had some sort of sentimental value to me because, you know, the comedy that I put in the special is all, you know, deeply personal stuff about my life from different angles and perspectives. And so, you know, it's talking about my upbringing. So I felt doing it at home was the right move. And fortunately, they were open to the idea and were nice enough to give me 2 nights to do the show. And people came out. We had a nice time. And you know, Michael Malone, a fellow comic, directed the special.
Oh, cool.
He's directed a couple of specials from peers of ours, and he made it look like a movie.
That's awesome.
It looks good. It sounds good. The angles are great. And yeah, and it feels like you're there.
Yeah. I was going to say, I watched today. The opening is fun. It's you backstage and you can hear muffled through the curtain, the warm up person giving the rules, like, don't heckle, shut the fuck up. And I was like, this feels real. This does feel like I'm right here.
Yeah. We filmed that on the second night because on the first night I had to lecture one of my dad's old friends.
Oh, about Jesus Christ.
How to behave at a comedy show. And of course this dude is sat front and center, and I'm so grateful to anyone who came to the show, you know, friends of mine, friends of my family's, you know, other people who just wanted to see a comedy show.
Right.
But like, I think the one drawback about performing where you're from is, you know, people have who have known you for so long before you started pursuing this artistic endeavor see you differently.
Yeah.
And I remember, this isn't in the special, I might see if I can get this little clip from Mike, but I had to say, I felt it during the first show, but I didn't have words for it. But in the second show, I felt it again, and I put words to it. And I said, because I mentioned a little bit in the special, the concept of me having sex. I refer to that.
And sure.
Who'd have thunk a comedian might express that?
Might do it.
But I could feel the audience pulling from me because there were a lot of people in the audience that were friends of my parents who had known me since I was, you know, 7 years old.
Right. You're not a man. You're parents' boy.
They still see me as their kid. And so
there's little Stewie talking about up there.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
And I said, you know, it's weird. You know, this is the one drawback of performing in your hometown is, like, I don't know if you guys know this, but I fuck. I've been fucking.
I stay fucking.
It would be weirder if I wasn't.
Yeah.
So I'm going to talk about this. And if you can't handle that, grow up.
Right.
And, or accept that I've grown up.
Yeah, exactly. And so I, you know, it was a weird moment, but I think it was funny to say it because, you know, you never think you're going to say certain sentences in a comedy set, let alone a filmed special.
Is this your first time you ever done stand-up in front of your parents or your parents' friends?
No. My parents are super supportive. And they if I'm doing a weekend of shows in the Bay Area where I'm from, they typically will come to, like, the Saturday early show that I describe as parent show.
Right.
Because it's like it's before their bedtime and it's on a weekend when they aren't working. Mm-hmm. So it's a typical date night outing for most audiences. So, like, you know, the difference between, you know, the different shows on a weekend, you know, Thursday show or a Wednesday show feels more like comedy fans.
Sure.
People who, like, they're going to come when all the dunderhead
tickets for cheap.
That's true.
All the cum talk is.
Yeah.
That's okay.
Yeah. At a premium. And, and the early shows on a Friday or Saturday are typically, you know, more of a date night kind of show. It's either after work or, like, after a long week of work. And so, but then the late shows, especially the Friday late show, I mean, can notoriously be a tough show because people have been working all week and they've gone to happy hour. And so they might end up at a comedy show already sloshed a little bit. And that's why it can be a bit of a wild card. But yeah, they typically come. But there were a lot of friends of theirs who had expressed interest in seeing me I've been doing comedy almost 15 years now. Mm-hmm. They said, we want to come to a show. And for whatever reason, they never come. But we said, hey, this is the show. And, you know, handful of them came, and most of them were really great.
I've been afraid of doing stand-up in front of any version of my parents for as long as I've been doing stand-up.
Do your parents have, like, multiple personalities?
No.
There's, like, multiple versions of them? Or?
Yeah, like,
when my dad's in his Dave phase.
Now, Dr. Jarobi, my dad's alter ego when he gets to drinking. No,
sure.
Phases of your own comedy?
Yeah, well, just, like, if they ever listen to an episode of this. And it's me being afraid that I'm going to disappoint them somehow.
Sure.
Not like they're going to, like, disown me or whatever. Mm-hmm. They're going to be super upset. But, like, I doubt they'd care, like, logically. But, like...
Right. Oh, my son, he has a podcast where he talks about pussy farts.
Because really,
how's my son doing? Oh, my God. Let me tell you.
I think most supportive parents just want to see you kill it. They don't care if you say, like, fart, fart, pussy, cum, whatever. They don't care. Like, as long as you're killing it. But, like, there's just, I don't know. I guess that is to say, like, did you have to, like, ramp up to this point where you're like, you're getting the show that I do? Or did you ever have to dial it down before?
No, I think there may have been one or two jokes that I've considered doing on, like, a different night. But I don't know if it was for my parents. It might have been for, like, a grandparent who was coming to a show.
Right. Because for a great-grandparent. Well,
I had three living grandparents when I started doing comedy. And so, like, they would come at different times. But I don't know if I really held back too much. I mean, I think they were pretty good. I mean, I don't consider myself a particularly dangerous or outlandish comedian. I feel
I would not say that about you at all.
Yeah, a lot of what I mean, you know, the pussy fart stuff is
that's what you're known for.
Sorry to get that out.
That's your Layla, but you got others. Derek of the Dominoes has other songs.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
it also shows, like, the level of skill it takes to because it's easier to make other open micers laugh by being like fart, fart, fart on boobs, and then, like, to actually do
funny.
Yeah, to make a set that's palatable for crowds.
Yeah.
And like, that involves wit and actual writing.
Yeah, the only thing that my parents have ever really gotten critical about in my experience is if something I was saying was so not based in factual accuracy that it was, like,
really
a complete distortion of reality.
Like, about personal stuff?
Yeah. Mostly stuff that related to them.
Yeah.
Oh, gotcha.
Like, I had a bit that I did for a long time. It's not on the special, but I have, you know, a video out of it. And if people want to find it, it's on my socials, about my mom getting super controlling about wanting to take a Christmas card photo. And she made a whole production of it whenever I would come home. That was like, because that it was like the one picture we would take as a family a year. We were not a big picture taking family throughout the year. So she had to make this one count. And I always found it a little strange because we would send it to 150 people that we barely knew.
It's going to be on their fridge for months. Yeah.
It was really just like a proof of life kind of thing.
Yeah. It's going directly in the garbage can. There's no.
Yeah. And
man, we hang them. We hang Christmas cards at our house.
Really?
Oh, fuck yeah.
Like a mobile.
Yeah. All the different ages.
Sure.
Yeah.
So my mom could not have really much of a critique of it because the act out that I do, I basically create the pose that I end up doing for one of these Christmas card photos that we had professionally taken.
Right.
And it's sitting in our living room. It's sitting in the living room of relatives of ours. So, like, it's all there. It's all based in some real cold hard facts. Mm-hmm. So if I was saying something that she wasn't actually doing, I think she would probably be bummed out by it. But, like, it's funny because it's true. And, you know, any friend of hers or anyone she knew that saw that bit were like, that's so Anne. Like, because it was. And so
essence of her, even if it's not, like, completely, that's not as it was actually happened. It's like, the essence of what makes it funny was interpreted. Yeah.
And I think, I mean, there is one bit where in the special that I think is a little bit of a bending of the truth where I say, I talk about my grandpa getting really old and, you know, he had dementia when he passed away after the special was recorded. So, like, this is, like, the last time I really got to talk about him in earnest. And he, he said he would hear my dead grandma calling him from beyond the grave. And I think that's why he's still alive. And I like, he hated her. I was like, he didn't really, but he's like, I just need a minute, Katie. Let me have some alone time.
There's
this really hot Jamaican nurse who changes my diet. I think I got a chance with her.
I think that was kind of a revelation for me, where it was like, it doesn't have to be like 100% factual retelling of, like, it has to be like a funny interpretation.
Yeah, we're not writing an oral history. I mean, it is an oral history, but it's from your perspective, and there's factual truth and there's emotional truth.
Right,
and
exactly.
And if you followed that whole saga that Hasan Minhaj had to deal with The New Yorker kind of like digging into the factual truth of his material, and he even talks about it in the interview, like there's factual truth and there's emotional truth. And I don't think I'm quite going to the level where I'm saying that, like, someone, you know, put anthrax on my baby.
Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, like, comedians get to weave a story, and it is coming from their perspective, and, like, you know, how they feel can sometimes manifest itself in a plot point in their story.
Right.
I don't know. I mean,
so does your mom try to argue a point about this joke?
If I run a bit by her, she will.
Uh-huh.
And that's why I run bits by other people now.
Right.
Good call.
And I love my mom. She's fantastic. And we just talk about other things. I'll run bits by her when they're more fully formed.
Right.
And we found a nice balance with that.
That's good.
That's the way to do it. It's like, hey, this thing's out, mom. You can listen to it if you want.
Hey, look, it's finished.
Yeah, it's finished. Yeah, finished product. Yeah.
People love it.
Yeah, exactly. As long as that's the thing, it's like, oh, well, yeah. Must be a reason.
Yeah.
Well, at the top of this broadcast, I would like to send a special shout out to the good people of Kanawha City, West Virginia. On Sunday night, hundreds of people gathered around a condemned building for a candlelight vigil celebrating the legacy of a beloved local landmark ahead of its demolition. The last Hooters in West Virginia closed during COVID-19. And
is that by proxy the last Hooters in America?
mean, if you can't have a Hooters in West Virginia, my God, what hope is there for the rest of us?
I'll tell you what.
What is there to look forward to?
I'll tell you.
I know.
Hoots.
Wait, is Hoots a PG Hooters?
It's a, it's like a counter service Hooters. Everyone behind the counter is ugly as sin.
Oh, I was about to say, it's just sex dolls.
I was going to say, is it an Instacart version of Hooters? Or
it's just like a restaurant. But
Hoots.
Everyone has just one good titty. And one that's questionable.
No, it's a bunch of dudes.
I was saying it's fully automated with sex robots.
Dudes with one good titty and one questionable titty.
Automated sex robots.
And yeah, automated sex robots like with what? One ball. And
I think they need to do automated service staff before they move them. Automated fleshlights.
Yeah, yeah. It just pops up like a whack-a-mole. Just like, how many wings?
Are we horny today?
But yeah, we should go. Pasadena has one.
Why are you fucking kidding me? Oh my God.
I'm not fucking kidding.
Take a road trip.
Jesus.
This is not factual truth. This is emotional truth.
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. It's actually Altadena. It's actually Altadena.
Sure.
But yeah, last Hooters in West Virginia, they closed in March of 2020. And just never reopened. Developers announced the building and
happened to almost all of them. Sorry to interrupt again, but that happened to almost every Hooters in America.
The pandemic shut them down.
Yeah.
That and the abandoned Captain D's next door are also going to be demolished today to make way for a Sheetz gas station. So, the candlelight vigil started out as a joke between friends, but it took off on social media, and hundreds of people, including some former Hooters employees, turned up to pay tribute to the restaurant. And this is
surely not the waitstaff like fry cook.
probably not the waitstaff. This is a quote from a woman. It says, Daniel Hughart, a former employee, said, I started coming, and I kept coming.
This is the best vigil I've ever been to.
I've never seen so much come in a vigil.
It says, I started out coming in to get a job, which that's almost like a great song intro. I started out coming in.
Yeah, it's a John Denver song, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Started out coming in West Virginia. Became a habit, put myself a white shirt on. But yeah, it says I got so much more because I met so many friends and coworkers. So yeah, this lady was hyped about it. And Leo Browning, one of the organizers, said that Hooters corporate office also learned of the vigil plans, and they mailed a box of big titty women calendars to be distributed to the building's mourners.
My God.
And, like a leaflet.
Yeah, they flew over like it's propaganda during the fucking Pacific campaign. Browning said,
"Here, guys, take these to your mechanic shop. Hang them on the bathroom wall." Yeah. Does anyone still have a paper calendar?
Well, apparently the good people of Kanawha City, West Virginia,
from years ago. I guess this is the calendar you keep around after the years.
Hell
over.
Yeah, bro! Mm. Yeah. You cut it up and then just put the individual pictures on the wall.
Yeah, make a collage.
Yeah, there we go.
All the other months are stuck together, so it's just March all year long.
And they ended up raising money for a sick child to travel to California for healthcare. So it was also one of those,
they're a company that cares.
Yeah. Well, no. This isn't the company. This is just the people who put this together.
This is a community effort.
They're like,
keep big business out of our sick kids.
No, they're like, wouldn't it be hilarious to have a candlelight vigil for a Hooters? And they're like, oh, we should probably also help out this child.
Was this
probably
the first?
Travis.
Was this the first super spreader event?
Well, no, this happened yesterday.
The super spreader was what you got to see on July of the calendar.
Yes, that's right. No, the vigil was for them just physically tearing down the restaurant. It closed during COVID, but it's just been sitting empty for 4 years.
Yeah.
So they heard they were tearing it down, got candles out, and then ended up, for a good cause, sending a kid to get health care. But it's also one of those, stories that's posing as something uplifting, and you're like, why the fuck did you have to do this? Send the goddamn kid to California to get their shit fixed.
Is the kid sick because the asbestos that was released when the building was demolished spread throughout the town?
It was the wings.
No, I think it was
a previously unsick kid. Yeah. I think it was flown to this.
This is a different kind of lemon pepper than I'm used to.
I think it's just living in West Virginia.
Yeah.
Because, they used to have thousands of mountains and now they've got hundreds, and all of the shit they blasted out of them are just in the water supply down there. So
Wait, they destroyed mountains in West Virginia?
Yeah, mountaintop removal. That's how they do coal. They don't mine for coal anymore. They just explode entire mountains and then shovel up all the shit they want. And turns out that wreaks havoc on the ecosystem, taking a mountain away. So West Virginia's fucked. Check out Mountain Justice. They're doing the hard work there, trying to rectify as much
Carter's
of that situation as possible.
That out.
What?
I can tell.
They take away mountains.
And now we have video proof of how sad he was. Zoom in.
How could they take away a mountain? Mountains are so beautiful. Why would you do that?
I fucking blew up that one mountain and put the slave owners' faces on it.
Hey, look, this podcast has been demystifying my Southern Rube mind for 5 years. So. How would you do that to a beautiful mountain? And the Hooters is gone. Well,
they took it away.
I do wish that they replaced the Hooters with a Come and Go gas station instead of a Sheetz.
They're getting rid of Come and Go.
Oh, they're getting rid of Come and Go?
Yeah, they've got bought by some company called, I think, Marathon, and they're changing all of the Come and Goes to Marathons.
Oh,
and I'm like, why? What's the point of touring the Midwest now?
Yeah.
If not for a half second giggle when you see the words Come and Go on a sign.
Well, now keep your shirts, everyone. They're vintage officially. Remember.
They're collector's items.
Yeah. eBay one day, they'll be worth $35.
It's that time. I'm getting a little thirsty. It's time for our ungodly concoction today. What do we got for him, Stuart?
This says Bee Goat.
That's right.
Clean energy, cascara plus beverage. The flavor is cascara berry. I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that right.
Yeah.
There's a nice little slogan at the beginning. Be your greatest of all time. 200 milligrams of caffeine.
Fuck yes. Now we're talking.
And only 7 net carbs.
That's right. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
This fits into my diet perfectly.
25 calories.
Yeah. It says there's also antioxidants and polyphenols.
We don't know what those are.
Fentanyl? Is that close to fentanyl?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Polyphenol's okay, but regular fentanyl.
Yeah.
Monofentanyl's not good.
Mono's, yeah. That's bad news.
12 grams of allulose.
Oh, that's a pond scum mixed with aluminum. them.
Oh, sick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. They put it in a blender. And
Is this Tom Brady's?
Guess which other retired athlete?
It's
West Coast.
West Coast.
Jerry Rice.
Yes.
Jerry really? Rice.
Yeah.
Well, no, are you serious?
No, not this one. So, confusingly, Jerry Rice has one called Goat Fuel.
What? Are you fucking kidding me?
This is Bee Goat.
Oh my fucking God.
Jerry Rice is getting into he has a bowl at Nick the Greek. He's all over the place these days.
They weren't here, but they were the only energy drink that's ever gotten across the board five stars.
Yeah, the pineapple cream soda from Mr. Jerry Rice. Shout out to Jerry Rice.
His bowl at Nick the Greek is good. He makes solid investments.
To try that out. This is made by the Bee Goat Beverages Company out of the city of Bend in Central Oregon. The website says it was established in 2019, but founded in 850 AD.
What?
Yeah. It was founded by the guy who watches after the Holy Grail.
This is some Knights Templar shit?
What's the expiration date?
Yeah, good question.
Very good question.
I did find it at
852.
I did find it at Sprouts. I think that's the last of my haul from Sprouts from the last time I was there. But now, according to the website, it says, legend says that an Ethiopian goat herder, Caldi, noticed that after eating some berries from a certain tree, his goats became so excited they did not want to go to sleep at night. Caldi reported his findings to the abbot of the local monastery, who made a drink with the berries, and that is how we got to
how many people have you told this?
Oh, this is why they win marathons. Okay.
They do make a reference. They do make a reference to greatest of all time, but this is literally like they're trying to call back to the coffee goats that gave us coffee, because
it's confusing because the other goat brand also has a goat on the can.
Right.
That's why I thought it was the same one.
Yeah. No, it is. That is downright confusing.
In this modern age, goats are having a moment. I know the difference.
Yeah, this is going to keep Jerry Rice from catching as much of a bag as he already is.
Well, so this is made from Cascara Plus, which Cascara traditionally disregarded during the coffee production process. Cascara is the fruit that surrounds the coffee bean.
Oh, okay. So it's like coffee bean skin?
Yeah, so it's bean, it's skin, it's all that shit. Yeah, and it's produced
crust. Crust.
Yeah, coffee's the Uncrustables of energy drinks.
It's like the runoff. It's like the malt liquor of coffee is what we're about to drink.
Pretty
coffee
much.
Is the pearl of this shit fruit.
Yes, exactly. They say it's bold, natural, and wholesome flavor with all the benefits of cold brew without the benefits of cold brew without the bitter taste. Mm-hmm. I guess
without the devil thoughts of cold brew.
Yeah.
No, they said all the benefits.
The benefits. You want
You want the shaky devil thoughts.
I mean, look, I have a glass of cold brew, a tall, frothy glass of cold brew every morning. So
really?
We'll see.
You make it yourself?
Oh, I have the good people at Starbucks do that for me.
Good. Just seeing.
You make it yourself?
I have, yeah. I had to stop because I drank too much of it and have devil thoughts.
I do love the idea of you being so hopped up energy wise because you seem like such a cool kid. It's like, this is me on coffee. It's like, whoa, no way.
Oh, I mean, when I'm super on caffeine, I turn into a chatty little bitch. That's for sure. That's for damn sure.
But it's just also chatty Cathy for sure.
He's like on his bed wrapping a phone cord around his finger.
Really?
What's new?
But
he kept saying, I never liked him anyway.
He kept saying ack.
Complaining about Mondays.
I don't know. All the devil thoughts stay inside me when I'm on caffeine. So I might be acting normal, but the inside is fucking going nuts.
I'll tell you.
I believe it. I mean, I'm sure I would be the same way. I mean, I'm more of a tea guy myself, so I'm interested to see how my body embraces or rejects
You have the measure and reserve of a tea person.
Yeah, when I tell people I drink tea, they're like, that checks out.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm just a little sensitive to caffeine. I'm kind of glad I am.
As a fellow cold brew person and always in between emergency bowel movements, I understand the devil thoughts, letting them go, embracing some of them.
Yeah, cold brew is too crazy. I can't. I just started drinking regular coffee.
I hate that I'm used to it. I really hate that I'm used to it.
I know.
And I get headaches if I don't get that level in the morning. Yeah,
you gotta switch to energy drinks.
Oh, God.
As best I can tell, the company is part of Axis Custom Brands, which is run by a guy named Tim Bags.
Great.
Tim Baggs.
I was going to say, you know what? I bet it's two M's and one G.
Tim Bags. At this point, I would like to issue a public apology to Kenny Chesney because I made fun of him.
He's been waiting.
I made fun of him for having a tiny little fucking acorn head. Man. Tim Bags makes Kenny Chesney look like he put in DK mode on James Bond. Like, he has the tiniest little acorn head I've ever
seen.
He's
got like the Beetlejuice waiting room thing going on.
Totally. And I'll put this up on Twitter so people can see it. But yeah, look at this teeny little fucking head on this
motherfucker. I don't know if it's small head or big forehead.
I mean, it could be either, but... Yeah,
not to body shame this man's head.
Oh, I'm totally comfortable with talking shit.
He's a little weird looking.
He does scream 5'4", even though we're only seeing him from the waist up.
Yeah.
Those aisles are taller than he is. In the background.
Those boxes of cereal eclipse him.
So, apparently this guy went to, like, a business retreat in Colorado in 1997, and the dude who brought Red Bull to America was there, and he held up the can before it was available to the public, and he was like, I'm about to change the world with this. Wow. And so this dude hopped on Monster Energy in 2000 and became, I think, the regional sales director of the Pacific Northwest. So he's very hilariously boring. According to Bags, on an archived version of Axis's website, because for reasons that I think will become clear in a moment, he's not very readily apparent on the website anymore. He used to have a big masthead, and now not so much. But he said, two of my favorite philosophies are work hard and play hard, and live for today but plan for tomorrow. I was like, you were just missing live, laugh, love.
Yeah, really takes the wind out of the sails with that second one.
Yeah.
Also, like, work hard, play hard. It's like, but still, maybe think about things once in a while.
Monster.
One in the hand is worth two in the bush. You know what I'm talking about? Penny saved is a penny earned.
So in 2004, he went on to found Charged Beverages. Quote, we were crushing a lot of energy drinks with vodka at the time, and thought it'd be really cool to mix one and have an energy alcohol drink in a can. And that's how it all began.
Oh, so they pioneered Four Loko?
Yeah, so he...
Ooh, I love this guy.
Simultaneously...
There's a lot of blood on this man's hands.
Yeah,
absolutely. His tiny, tiny little hands.
A lot of vomit on his hands.
It makes sense that the company's called Axis, because this sounds like he's about to commit a war crime.
Maybe.
He is the Mussolini of of energy drinks. He's been called that.
So in November of 2010, the FDA declared highly caffeinated malt liquors to be a public health concern, and Bags had to stop selling his Core High Gravity Orange and Lemon Lime Core Spiked drinks, amongst others. So he and Four Loko were banned at the same time. He was never involved with them. Mm-hmm. He had his own shit going on.
We all remember where we were.
Yeah, yeah. And as stated on the website, B-Goat was founded in 2019. Let's go ahead and do this. This is everyone's really favorite part of the show. Please hold.
Yeah, he's really into it. And the piss noise that he loves it.
You gotta start doing it on camera. Reverse.
Yeah.
Camera. Oh, daddy.
Yeah. No one loves this more than Rivers. I don't think anyone even likes this.
Everyone loves it so much.
There's multiple it's parts of the podcast where that's the case, I think.
Show.
I do picture an alternate universe where you get some really long acrylics and you like tap the glass and create a TikTok around like just pouring energy drinks.
It's so foul. Yeah.
Absolutely good.
This is going to turn into this podcast is going to like just devolve into like mug banging energy drink.
It smells like watered down, like Snapple.
I like it, which is going to make me upset if I like this, based on what I'm about to tell you.
The smell
makes Rivers a randy little goat, doesn't it?
it tastes like a blue raspberry.
Oh, shit, it's awful. Oh, Christ, it's bad.
It tastes like a blue raspberry sort of thing.
Rare turnaround. Great smell. Oh shit! Yeah, that's fucking rotten.
The smell is nothing. The smell is like it tastes. The smell is like a drink that's been sitting around for a day, and it's kind of like an old fast food paper cup, and all the ice is melted in.
Right.
And you're like, could I drink this? I'm thirsty for water. And you smell, and you're like, no, I can't. I can't drink this.
This
My
thing
life will be fucked.
This thing's taste comes in three parts, where it hits you with like tart, and then a little bit sweet, and then cardboard. Those are the three tastes, like unfolding, like one of them fortune tellers.
I'm not even getting the sweet. I'm just
it's like a minute. It's a split second of sweet, tart, little bit of sweet, and then just back ends.
Yeah.
And it's not, I don't know if tart's even the right word. It's a weird sour.
Citric acid.
Yeah.
Preservative.
Water, sour. Yeah. Sour and then.
Water, sour, mountain gone.
Mountain gone, bad, cry, want to cry.
So there are nearly 1,200 people experiencing homelessness in Central Oregon on any given night. Now, why would I be mentioning this? Well, Tiny Head Bags co-founded an organization called Bend Humanity Coalition, which is currently trying to bend humanity in half by criminalizing homelessness in Bend, Oregon. So he's fucking cool.
Okay, I don't feel as bad about commenting on his tiny head.
Exactly. Yeah, no, let it loose. Fuck this dude. They are attempting to ban camping on public property, handing out fines for littering, and arresting people for open container laws. Quote, it would be great if they enacted mandatory sobriety laws for all shelters and homeless campers as well. Create boundaries and accountability. And I'm like, how did you make your money again? Was it the malt liquor, you fucking piece of shit?
Four Loko knockoff.
Yeah. Tell me more about these drunk winos you want off the street.
He's had community well-being at the forefront of his tiny head for
it. Yeah. And so I saw this and I just assumed that this tiny headed moron is, you know, just maybe some NIMBY, but like ultimately apolitical fucking Oregon guy. Nope. I found his Twitter. It is at Teabags, which is shout out.
He
has 35 followers and is currently
he's about to have 36.
He is currently following Ron DeSantis, Andrew Tate, Tucker Carlson, libs of TikTok, Ben Shapiro, and Elon Musk, and he is liking and replying to a lot of anti-vaccine stuff, anti-abortion stuff, and tons of transphobic nonsense.
That makes sense, because when I sipped that, I felt my most recent COVID booster evaporate.
And turn your blood into nanobots. Saying,
now I'm down to four, Was it five? Now I'm at four.
I gotta make another appointment at CVS.
I think a tooth of mine disintegrated.
Also, Tiny Head Bagman does not know how to spell pedophiles. Keeps spelling it with an F instead of a PH.
It is so hard to take people seriously when they can't spell the name they're calling you wrong.
I think they, in theory, care about a lot.
Well, I think he's referring to the pedo file.
Yeah. Oh, maybe so.
Like the file that he has that has all of the pedophiles in it. It's a physical file.
Maybe so. And it's not even just because he sucks. That's terrible. Like, I was ready to be like, give credit where credit's due if that was in any way good.
I was ready to be a goat.
Now
it's got to be me.
So, one pretty star bad. For me.
I'll give it a two. Yeah. I mean, 1.5. Two is generous.
Yeah.
Too much caffeine is a drawback for me. I know you guys like it, but I don't like it.
No.
Because I think as I drink so much cold brew in the morning, so like too much caffeine and it tastes like shit, I'm going to give it a one star. That's bad.
If the point of it being called Be Goat was for it to taste like garbage, then five stars.
The thing that goats eat.
It was like, oh, this is actually just made for goats.
It's the they do eat cardboard and shit for real.
It's made for livestock.
They should change it to For Goat.
There we go.
Well, goat means garbage only, actually taste.
Trash.
Yeah, greatest of all trash, yeah.
There we go.
I'm trying to do that on the fly. I think it worked.
I think you nailed it. Yeah.
Grossest of all trash.
There it is.
Okay.
Be goat.
Yeah, grossness on all tongues.
There it is. I was talking to Stuart downstairs, and then I stopped my thought because I realized I hadn't said this on the show, but I wanted to tell you guys. So as you've seen, I'll start looking up these people and find out crazy shit. The last time we did, because we've talked about Rip It many times on the show, Rip It is made by the same people who make Faygo, and they have an exclusive
not ICP.
Yeah, no, they don't until
they don't make it. They just push it
until the old lady dies. They don't want nothing to do with ICP. So, but. No, they have Rip It has an exclusive contract with the Department of Defense to distribute that on all the battlefields of our imperialist expeditions. And the last time we did it, I you know mentioned that on the show, and then I had a show that night. This is when I was back in Alabama. We recorded in Birmingham, and then I did the show afterwards. A guy came up to me.
You seem like you get a lot of people that come up to you after shows.
Oh yeah. Oh, I love it.
River, oh yeah.
River stands next. Oh, bathroom, buddy! After the show, and he's like, "Hey, hey, guys!
I got a secret to tell you."
He's underneath people's cars. Hey, dog!
But a guy told me that while he was in Afghanistan, that warlords they love Rip It. And apparently,
just generally warlords,
their shit would get raided for Rip It's.
Okay.
Like they'd be at some Ford operating base outside Kandahar.
As they call it, atrocity soup.
Yeah, yeah. And in the middle of the night, a bunch of, you know, shooting would start and everybody gets in their positions and they come back into camp or whatever and their Rip It's gone because it got taken by a warlord.
Wow.
So he was really into Rip It.
End the war just by giving them soda.
I mean,
is that all they want?
It would shorten the life a little bit. You
That's
know,
why those guys
away.
In Al-Qaeda could really do the monkey bar so well.
Oh, yeah.
In those initial videos.
They're ripping it.
Yeah. There we go. They were all hopped up. I have a story out of Glasgow, Scotland that I wanted to share with you guys.
The homeland.
This is Elizabeth Carpin writing for the New York Post. So, police were called to Willie's Chocolate Experience in Glasgow, Scotland on Saturday.
Hitting on over to Willie's.
Oh, the Willie. Willie the groundskeeper's chocolate experience.
On Saturday, after parents felt scammed by the, quote, absolute shambles of an event and gathered to demand refunds from the event, coordinated by an organization called House of Illuminati.
You call this House a fucking experience?
Yeah.
I came here for an experience. So, an experience.
This is
so it's House of Illuminati, not Illuminati?
Illuminati.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, House of...
Yeah, not the deep dish pizza Illuminati. From Chicago.
Yeah. Deep House of Illuminati.
There they call it deep state pizza.
Deep state pizza.
Yeah, this is very much like a we don't have the rights to Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, so they're doing something pretty similar.
Yeah.
Like but, the Austin Powers themed bar here.
Yeah, so the Star Wars scum and villainy cantina, that sort of thing.
Got it.
The event cost $45 a person and promised a, quote, paradise of sweet treats. They advertised chocolate fountains, an enchanted garden, an imagination lab...
Great.
That's just an empty room, right? And they're like, fucking go crazy. Yeah, imagine whatever you want.
Just go in and think about things.
Yeah.
There's a chair for you. Let your imagination run wild.
A twilight tunnel, which that sounds, I don't like that.
It's the last like thing you see before you die.
Go to sleep. Walk through the tunnel and go to sleep.
That twilight.
One of those arches that has Christmas lights all on top of it. Yeah.
But it's like shooting like a you know some sort of anesthetic gas down on you.
Go to sleep.
That's your ancestors calling you home.
Yeah. They also offered supposedly handcrafted candy drinks. Parents complained that they waited for more than an hour for an experience that ended up being less than 10 minutes long. Children were brought to tears as they were walking.
Hello, police. My kids are upset.
Yeah. Yes. So, yeah, children were brought to tears as they were walked into a nearly empty warehouse with...
I told you, the imagination station.
This is the imagination zone.
This is the Jack Handy burned out warehouse thing.
Yes,
one thing kids like is to be tricked. For instance, I was going to take my little nephew to Disneyland, but instead I drove him to an old burned-out warehouse. Oh no, I said, Disneyland burned down. He cried and cried, but I think that deep down he thought it was a pretty good joke.
Yeah. So they had, inside the warehouse, AI-generated backgrounds that were printed on paper. Like, this looks like, imagine having just a standard child's birthday party, but in like a warehouse where you could potentially play a game of basketball.
And wow. Not even a standard one, like a poor person's version. They're like printing out images off a computer and taping them to a fucking wall.
So they had lackluster props and virtually no candy. Quote, the children were all dressed up and they were all crying, waiting for what they thought was a magical experience.
You could also just buy your kid candy.
Did
they ever consider that as an option?
I mean,
yeah, I think that would have been the cut out the middleman. Cut out.
Have to go to Willy Wanker's house. Yeah. They get this experience.
This is another quote.
Third eye open, laddie. There'll be candy at the end.
This is another quote. Underwhelming was an understatement. Embarrassing doesn't even cut it. I paid for Willy Wonka and I got Billy Bonkers, one angry mom wrote on social media.
No, you paid for Billy Bonkers.
You did. It doesn't say Willy Wonka.
I got Billy Bonkers. Did she say that from a moving car?
Back to stabbing a guy for a football game score.
Yeah, I mean, like, if... That is a thing in Glasgow. Like,
I was going to say.
That's such a, like, stabbings are just, it's like the stabbing capital of the world.
Yeah, that's what I was really? Going to say. I was like, this shit is bold in Glasgow specifically. Because you will get shanked. You will absolutely get shanked for less than this.
That's strange.
It says.
It seems like going to, like, the place where, like, the Chuck E. Cheese animatronics are made, but they're all in just shambles.
If it was that, that would be less disappointing than what it actually is.
It's not even a Five Night at Freddy's sort of situation.
No. So this is another quote. It says, took 2 minutes to get through the entire thing, and then I just see a queue of people surrounding the guy running it, complaining. The kids all received 2 jelly beans and a quarter can of Limeade.
Wow.
A quarter can? Had it been opened?
So there were other people that were like, my kid just got like a quarter of a cup. So I think they were literally like pouring 3 cups and then handing the fourth kid
trying to even
can.
It out.
Candy! Yeah. Here comes candy! Yeah. Everybody gets their share. Yeah.
They must have not sold very many tickets this thing, right?
Well, no, I think they sold too many.
They sold too many because they're having to give away 2 jelly beans and a quarter cup of fucking lemonade.
2
Seems
jelly
like
beans.
All those tickets would cover the cost of like a third jelly bean. Possibly.
But where's the profit then?
Yeah. So
we're barely in the black.
Paula Graham came with her husband and 8-year-old daughter and the girl's friend. She said she felt cheated by the AI-generated advertising. Quote, their page and advertising looked very professional. They made it out as if it was going to be a really special experience. Graham said, according to The Sun, in my eyes, I thought it was going to be some kind of light show with actors.
And his expectations were already so low.
I don't know. That sounds
a light show with some actors.
That sounds too high to me.
I figured they'd be juggling or something.
I wouldn't expect it to be this bad, but I would not expect any sort of show or acting. I thought it'd be a chocolate fountain. They were like, dip this chocolate in the other chocolate.
I mean, left over from some winter ball at a high school. Yeah.
They had to scrape the nacho out of the hose.
Yeah, I mean, people are getting what they pay. This is a thoughtless last minute birthday party idea. They threw a bunch of adjectives at these parents and are like, great. Yeah. That works.
Step into the sleepy hole. It sounds like a Saturday.
Sounds like my Saturday is booked.
Wait, did they like almost literally take candy from babies? I mean,
kind of. Quote,
that's the whole business plan.
Quote, it was shocking. For the money you paid, there were kids coming away crying. Families came from all over. Then they put out a bit of cardboard out the front that said, event canceled. It was as if the chocolate factory had been shut down. So now it is the Jack Handy thing. How am I going to explain to my kid that the chocolate factory isn't shut down?
These people are like, they are just Americans. After this is just a classic American Karen story.
Hey, you know,
where I bought tickets to a stupid thing and now I'm mad about it.
That part of Europe used to be attached to the Appalachians billions of years ago.
So they blew up the mountains.
So it's shut down now.
I think they were open for like 3 hours and they called the cops.
I was like, so there's no existing Yelp of this.
No, it was just like a one-day thing.
It was a pop-up.
Yeah, it was a pop-up. It was literally a pop-up, and they set this thing up. People were paying all this money. They go in. They're like, this is bullshit, and then enough of them got
pop-up
pissed.
Can be short for flash scam.
Yeah, definitely. So,
pop-up as in, this wouldn't last more than one day, and we know it.
But don't miss out on this experience.
Yeah.
I just love in 2024 how anyone thinks that like the model of like a factory setting is going to be considered like an alluring event space.
This cold, impersonal factory.
Yeah. Let's put chocolate in the Industrial Revolution.
Yeah.
Every child's dream.
I like how people, I mean, this is literally like an 1800s scam, like snake oil salesman. Mm-hmm. This is the video for Say, Say, Say by Michael Jackson and Paul McCartney. Right. You can't do this now.
Yeah.
Jenny Fogarty was hired.
Watch that video.
That's a great video. it's a shame they weren't talking towards the end.
Yeah. I'm going to take your songs.
Yeah.
As he says in that VH1 thing.
Jenny Fogarty was hired to portray a wonky doodle, the events version of an Oompa Loompa. And
okay. Oh, I didn't buy tickets to see Billy Bonkers.
Yeah, you did.
Bullshit.
Yeah.
Regular sized person painted orange.
Just walking on their knees. Really.
But there's shoes on their kneecaps.
Yes. Jenny was shocked when she was given a sexy Oompa Loompa costume from an Amazon box that had only arrived an hour before the event.
It's here, great. Open it.
Yeah.
Quote, I noticed that the costumes, they were all female and were given the sexy versions as opposed to the traditional Oompa Loompas.
There was a bulk sale.
Yeah.
It's all profit.
Some people had to put t-shirts underneath to give a bit more modesty. I just had a lacy shirt underneath mine. So... It's just a bunch of sexy.
So this is like Hooters for kids with chocolate. But like, no chocolate, just two jelly beans.
Yeah. Also, I like that it is essentially like with a quarter cup of limeade and two jelly beans. It is sort of like taking pills at a mental asylum.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Take two of these and call me in the morning.
Yeah. Is this a chocolate factory or Jonestown?
Yeah.
I was going to say. One flew of the cuckoo's nest, you palm those pills.
Yeah, there we go.
Then you break into Nurse Ratched's office at night.
Chief, where's the chocolate? Where's the chocolate, Chief? We gotta make it to the dam.
Fogarty also claimed that she was given a 15-page script to memorize for the event, but was told that since they were out of time, she would just improvise instead.
Just riff about chocolate.
Apparently there was supposed to be a show of some kind, but they handed him the script like 2 days before, and they're like, "Oh, and by the way, here's the sexy Oompa Loompa costume you have to wear."
I wish we could have access to that script.
I know.
It's probably a banger.
Yeah.
I bet it's like 30 pages long.
Well,
do you think it's overwritten or underwritten?
15, right?
It's 15 pages.
That's so many.
There is a Facebook group called House of Illuminati Scam that I didn't have time to check out, so I'll scope it out and see if I can get hold of the script. But House of Illuminati apologized in a statement, and they acknowledged that its fabulous event had unfortunately failed to meet expectations. And had devolved into a stressful and frustrating day for everyone.
Fucking tremendous.
Whiz bang entertainment.
It was an experience.
That was lost on some charlatans.
It was an experience. They cannot lie. They can't say it wasn't an experience.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, because everything's a fucking experience.
Yeah. Fogarty said that she has not been paid for her work. Quote, it's shocking. It's embarrassing, to be honest. We were trying our best, all the actors, to make it work, but we were given just 12 hours to learn the script. And when we finally got back to our cars, that's when we saw the police showed up. Just
the universal sign of a show gone bad.
Yeah. Just walking back to the car. Wonky doodle doople doop doop.
Bombing is never quite as stinky as when the cops show up.
I feel like we've all had like shows like that or odd jobs like that
mm-hmm.
here in Los Angeles, where it's like,
oh yeah,
it's like they ask you to show up and they're like, hey, can you memorize all of this? The show's in an hour. And it's
yeah,
like,
yeah.
What?
Yeah, yeah.
I've definitely had auditions where they're like, all right, here's the Bible for the show.
Right, right.
Oh yeah,
and it's literally the Bible. You have to memorize.
Yeah, yeah.
I had a voiceover audition where that was 5 pages of AI script. And they're like, this is due in 3 hours.
Wait, were you supposed to be the... You know,
I was supposed to be the voice of AI.
That's what I was wondering. Yeah, yeah.
So it was like every contingency was like, I don't know. I was like, command, control, escape is how you exit the program. Like, it was like every, but it was like due like in a matter of hours.
Wow.
Like,
shit.
And after that, my agent was just like, you know, nothing ventured, nothing gained. I was like, you're not going to get that one.
It's like literally a computer could do this. It did do this. That's insane. Last thing here, Billy Cowell, director of House of Illuminati, blamed the disaster on, quote, holographic technology not arriving on time, bizarrely claiming that the event would have looked exactly as promoted if the tech had gotten there in time.
Yeah, tried to bring the technology from 2035. It didn't make it in time.
So
then we couldn't find an outlet.
I'll put some of these pictures up on Twitter. There's one of the entrances that appears to be made out of cardboard and crepe paper.
Pretty magical.
This looks like an airport terminal.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah, does. Yeah. And then just
busted out windows.
A massive pinata in the middle of an airport terminal.
Great.
This is the entrance to factory. It just says factory.
Oh, that's where the show's going to happen.
Yeah.
All the benches are set up.
All those stanchions and fabric.
No, this is where the shows are going to happen, on the stage level here, Sam. This is
the AstroTurf stage.
Yeah. Now, what I'm about to show you.
As a kid, I'm pretty happy at this point.
Yeah, I would be fine with this.
Wait,
you wouldn't, because you don't get any candy, which is the whole fucking reason you'd want to go.
That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
But like, I don't know, running around and being an asshole in this, that was my favorite thing to do as a kid.
Yeah, you can run around.
Wide open space.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just scream and shit. Who cares?
They're just screaming, saying like, if you want to learn paradise.
Yeah, yeah.
And the rowers keep rowing. They show new side of slowing.
Nothing. You get nothing. You lose.
Good day, sir.
Good day.
You stole fizzy lifting drinks. You fucker.
And then someone yells, get him a belly.
That's what they say every morning.
Yeah.
That's actually how the Scottish people greet each other when they wake up. Hello, good morning, and they get in my belly.
And they get in my belly too. Of pure imagination.
And then the other says, good morning, donkey. That is how they
speak of donkeys.
Yeah, yeah. Now, I'm not to take anything away from the photograph of them raising the flag over Iwo Jima, but this might be my favorite photo I've ever seen. Here we go. Right. This is one of the oopily doopilies at what I think is supposed to be a candy.
It's a meth lab for sure. It's like, a meth lab. Yeah,
like bongs I've hit before.
A fucking meth lab.
Yeah, this is a real Walter White Let's Cook moment.
It's amazing.
And she is the one who knocks for sure.
And she says, please get me out of here.
Maybe that's what the sexy Oompa Loompa costume was, like the one who knockers.
What is that in the glass case? Some sort of perfume or tonic bottle,
you know, fizzy lifting drink, perhaps. Who knows?
Yes. Yeah. It's Sauvage. Just the Johnny Depp.
The expression on her face, and then also just the fact that somebody set off a little fog machine.
Yeah.
It's just priceless.
Yeah,
pretty sweet.
I love it.
Yeah, she's trying to cure her own hangover.
If only they had some flashing lights in there, things would have been different.
Yeah,
it really would have sold it.
Really spur on some epileptic seizures.
An experience.
Yeah. So he says, my vision of the artistic rendition of a well-known book did not come to fruition. And for that, I'm absolutely, truly, and utterly sorry. There was every intention to hold the event from the pictures, despite not being in the best light. Hopefully you'll be able to see that there was every intention made to hold the event.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway.
Well, let me ask you guys, what's like, we've all been to a bad haunted house, right?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah, I say so.
Yeah. What's, I mean, I guess what is it? Is it like a certain age that you reach that when you go to like it's they all of them become bad? Like I was like to the point of like if I was a kid, like there's like on some level this would be like I guess somewhat bemusing, but like yeah. like I don't know. I guess like are all of these bad at a certain age?
I think it's directly related to how much effort is put into making them.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Like, did you ever acknowledge a haunted house is bad when you were a kid?
Yeah, I mean, I've definitely gotten ones and it was just like, that wasn't that fun, or I thought it would be more or whatever, you know?
I didn't go to a lot of haunted houses, but I think what kind of helped me not be able to suspend my disbelief was when I started knowing actors that were in the scary groups. Sure.
Oh, it's and Kyle Clark. What's up, Kyle?
Yeah, when I would recognize someone in the group that was trying to grab me in the haunted house, like Jesse.
Yeah.
I was like, dude.
That happened when I used to work at like a used bookstore in Birmingham, and it was like that we sold comics, so a lot of nerds would come in. And then I went to this haunted house in Sloss Furnace, and a guy that came into the bookstore all the time was dressed in like a cloak, and he had like a plastic scythe or whatever. And I was like, oh, what's up, man? And he avoided me like the plague.
Yeah, gotta keep kayfabe, brother.
Yeah.
You're supposed to be scared.
Because he was like really doing his best, like lurchity sort of.
What a fucking experience.
Yeah. I think the issue here is that the parents pumped this up too much.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if I mean, the fact that it costs $45, that's a separate issue. But the fact that, you know, they were probably like, oh, it's going to be like Willy Wonka, it's going to be magical. If they were just like, if they were like, just get in the goddamn car, we're going to a thing.
You know that there was some nice peacekeeper little kid who was like, it was fine. It was all right.
Yeah,
it was
still
a good birthday. And you know, like the dad was like, no, it was fucking shite.
I'm going to stab this motherfucker.
It was fine. We're all a family still. And that's what's imperative.
Yeah, yeah. Where is he? Let me at him.
Yeah.
Has anyone ever been to a thing called an experience that wasn't dog shit? Or, you know, it was fun in any sort of way? I have.
When you can't be specific enough to call it something other than an experience,
yeah,
it's troublesome. I was at
my physical therapist yesterday, and there's this woman there, and she was like almost like a typical LA like social media like. And she was like, oh, I'm so tired today. I had an event yesterday. And then the day before I put on a big event and I'm just so tired. And so then she just keeps talking about it. And then these events,
like, you want me to ask you about this.
Events are, they're aerobics classes that she keeps referring to as events.
Yeah.
And then as she's getting worked on, she starts showing the social media videos to her therapist.
Is she like a giving Peloton person?
No, or? It's, I think in real life, she's just like on stage with a microphone. Mm-hmm. And
is she a SoulCycle person? Or?
I didn't want to talk to her. She was calling her job an event.
She wanted you to talk to her about their events.
There's a lot of people who have spent too much money printing up cards that say event coordinator on them who have no business.
And then the therapist was being nice to her and she was like, oh, you have such a cool life. And she's like, oh, sometimes I just think my life is so crazy, you know? And it was just like one of those.
So crazy and full of purpose. People really want to hear about it, like, especially strangers next to me.
Did you learn how to act from watching reality TV? Is that like your basis for your entire personality?
I think that's how a lot of people think about how to behave.
Oh, for sure. God,
it's because
sick.
You know, if most of what you watch is reality TV, and it feels like these people are actually doing what they claim to be doing, then it's like, okay, this is just how people move around in the world.
Especially in Los Angeles, where it's like, I am the star of my narrative.
Yeah.
Well, that's why you throw the main events. You're not an exercise teacher. You throw events. Yeah. It's just like, what?
Yeah.
I throw social movements.
So. I'm Che Guevara.
Yeah.
And I make candles. So.
Well, you literally like see flyers or stuff in LA that's just like networking event, VIP tables, $900. Stuff like that. Yeah. It's just like a club party almost that's really expensive to get into that's an event
but then
or an experience.
But then you end up with the B-Goat motherfucker and the Red Bull guy and you can...
And you start plotting on how to get rid of all the homeless people.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Like, oh, it only costs $900 to get in here. What a deal.
Yeah, yeah.
It costs $900 to learn about eugenics.
A segment on this show where we talk to our guests about their hometown, and today Stuart Thompson joins us from, I don't even know how to explain it, it's Oakland, but it's kind of not Oakland.
Yep.
What is it?
I lived in a bunch of different parts of the Bay Area, Northern California. I was born in San Francisco, but when I was 10 through high school, I lived in a town called Piedmont, California. And Piedmont is, the way I would describe it is like, if you think of Oakland like a donut, Piedmont would be the hole if you moved it up a little bit.
Yeah.
So all these neighborhoods in the early 1900s eventually coalesced to become what is now Oakland, California. Mm-hmm. And Piedmont was one of those neighborhoods, and all these neighborhoods around Piedmont became part of Oakland. And Piedmont, for some reason, just said, nah. We're going to be our own thing. And it is kind of secluded because it's in the foothills of the Oakland Hills. And it over time became this, you know, wealthy little, it is a city, but it's missing a lot of aspects of a city. Like, there's no post office in Piedmont. You have to go to Oakland to find a legit post office. There's no grocery store, really. There's a couple gas stations in the center of town where the schools are. And there's like a convenience store and like a couple banks, but it's mostly a residential community where, you know, a lot of people who've, you've been quite successful in their, you know, white collar job, live, and the houses, the property taxes are very high, so the schools are very well funded. So that's why we moved there.
Because I was reading up about it, the park. It's got this
Piedmont Park.
It's got Piedmont Park, which guy who founded the park planted shitloads of palm trees on the in the middle of it.
Yeah,
and the entire thing was sort of a private park for a while, and is it now? It's now a city park, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. And anyone can hang in it.
Yeah, because for a while they were charging a fee to get in there. This is like the, you know, 1870s, 1880s,
like the world's shittiest amusement park.
Yeah, kind of, and.
The world of Lou Malnati's part two.
Trust me, this is an experience.
But I want to talk about Jack London.
I mean, Jack London is a figure in Bay Area culture, but like, he, you know, Jack London Square is in Oakland, and the seam between Piedmont and Oakland is very strange because like the prominent boulevard that goes through Piedmont is called Oakland Avenue.
Right.
And the and one of the prominent roads that goes through Oakland is called Piedmont Avenue.
Yeah.
So it just makes no fucking sense.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Some city planner was just angry and just said, fuck it, switch them. Yeah.
They use the park as the meeting spot for something called the Ruskin Club, which
the
was
Ruskin Club.
A
okay.
group of dickheads who were fans of the very annoying English art critic and philosopher whose name is John Ruskin.
Oh, okay.
And John Ruskin, because the whole thing with Jack London is that he was like a diehard socialist that also believed in like racial hierarchy and rugged individualism.
Yeah.
So he's basically like just an asshole.
London believed in these things?
Oh, yeah. Jack London, when Jack Johnson started winning.
So when Jack Johnson wrote all those Hawaiian songs.
No. When
her eyes are as big as her bubbly toes.
Jack,
and that means she's a better person than other people.
Yeah. Jack London is the guy who coined the phrase the Great White Hope. Because Jack Johnson won the world title.
The boxer
won the title, and he said,
not always waiting for you.
Yeah, yeah. He was like, Jim Jeffries needs to get the fuck out of the alfalfa farm and
you know, beat this guy's
another
ass.
Jim Jeffries?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
These are all double name
famous
people.
Yeah. Jim Jeffries.
Yeah, they're it's the Australian Jim Jeffries versus
Jack Johnson, the singer songwriter.
Okay. Yeah. No, Jim Jeffries retired as a way to as the world champion to duck Jack Johnson because he didn't want to fight him. He didn't want to lose to him, so he retired.
I don't want to fight him.
Yeah.
I've got a show on FX. I'm going to be concerned about.
That was a big thing back then. They didn't want to fight because they knew they'd get their ass kicked, and they didn't want to do it because they'd get their ass kicked by a black guy.
Yes.
Yeah. And that he was getting ducked hard.
Yeah.
Until he was the champion and they could no longer duck him.
Yes. Yeah. Well, he and eventually Jack Johnson wins the titles and they get Jim Jeffries to come out of retirement and they box in Reno and Jim Jeffries gets the shit beaten out of him. And you can see most of it on YouTube, which is great. It's old timey grainy footage, but boy, it's great.
Yeah. I'm excited to hear about that on his next special.
Yeah.
I didn't want to fight the black guy. But then they're like, oh, come on, Jim. You can do it.
Come out of retirement for one more. Come on.
But Ruskin is also the socialist philosopher, and I was trying to figure out, like, all right, what was his deal? And I'm like, oh, this is where Jack London got this shit, because he says, if there be any one point insisted upon throughout my works, that point is that there is an impossibility of equality. My continual aim has been to show the eternal superiority of some men to others, and sometimes even one man to all others, and to show the advisability of appointing such persons or person to guide, lead, or on occasion compel and subdue their inferiors and according to their own better knowledge and wiser will. So again, socialist, except instead of workers of the world unite, it's like white people unite and everybody else kind of fall in line.
Yeah, the rest of y'all figure it out.
Yes, which eventually gives way to national socialism.
Right.
Yeah, right. And but anyway, this is what's happening at Piedmont Park.
We're talking about
this guy's shit.
I mean, I've never had a better reason to not be into civic pride. But I mean, like, but it's interesting. I wonder how much of that is stuff that people in Piedmont actually know about, because it was definitely not discussed much in school.
Well, I was watching, like, they had a documentary about Piedmont Park, and they just blast past it. They're like, this is where the Ruskin Club met, with included Jack London, and they start mentioning all these people, and I was like, fucking John Ruskin? And I went looked. I was like, oh yeah, this. The only thing I knew about him going to this is that he had a complete mental breakdown.
Ruskin during
his last like tour. He would do speaking tours of Europe, and he was an art critic. And the impressionist Claude Monet scrambled his brain so fucking hard that he like had a total come apart, because he would show up and talk.
I've succumbed to the lilies.
Yeah, straight up. He'd show up for an art talk and all the students were like, yeah, this is bullshit though. We like the impressionist. And he had a complete mental breakdown, but
can't handle a bridge over a pond.
Yeah. Yeah. So while he was in Piedmont, Jack London wrote half of The Sea Wolf and all of Call of the Wild. So his biggest book was written there. And he had a friend group that they called themselves The Crowd, and they spent Sunday afternoons
garbage.
They spent
the wolf pack.
Yeah.
The wolf pack would be better.
That would be better.
Men of a certain age.
It would make The Hangover seem a lot more profound.
They spent Sunday afternoons picnicking, reading each other's latest compositions, gossiping about each other's infidelities, and frolicking beneath the cherry boughs in the hills of Piedmont. Yeah, straight up. you fucked my wife. I fucked her wife. What? So he's hanging out with Ambrose Bierce and George Sterling up there. So that was the one thing I read about your hometown. Except the other thing, what's the deal with the bird calling contest?
Oh, yeah. So my high school would do this bird calling contest every year.
So it is your high school.
Yes. Piedmont High School would do this bird calling contest where people would compete and they would, you know, you'd do it in our big high school theater, the Allen Harvey Theater. At least that's what it was called when I was there. And at some point when they were doing the bird calling contest, David Letterman realized how much he loved it.
Whoa.
And he would have the winners go on to Letterman and perform their bird calls.
Oh, yeah.
So if you won the bird calling contest, you got a Letterman credit.
And that
is my one regret.
I was going to say
comedy, because I started comedy when I went to college. And I never thought the bird calling contest was something that I wanted to do, but I could do impressions. So like I conceivably figured one out. And I wonder, like, could I have gone into comedy out of the open mic level with a Letterman credit?
Yeah, definitely.
I was gonna say, like, did this plant a seed maybe of like? So you had been doing comedy at this point.
I had not been doing comedy in high school.
I
just love being funny with my friends. Spanish class, we'd have to write dialogues, and so we treated it like a sketch writing. Seminar essentially, and we'd create recurring characters, and we loved SNL and Conan. I had not quite bridged into Letterman appreciation at that time, but I just thought, I was like, oh, this weird thing that people get to do, but these nincompoops would get onto Letterman. And I was like,
he's fucking amateurs.
I mean they were nice people, sure, but it was just like, they're not funny or anything. They didn't have a tight five.
They didn't do the work.
I need y'all to hear one of these bird calls. This is from David Letterman's show in 2001.
Sarah Heilbronn, ladies and gentlemen, the Storm Petrel.
Call of the Storm Petrel.
No bird. They don't compare it with the actual call of the bird.
Yeah, right. They should play
they
that.
They just take this woman at her word.
Look at this woman is willing to do on national television.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask, is because like I've watched a lot of footage of these bird callers, and some of these people you could tell are taking it very seriously, and then other people are like going for the laugh. Where like they had one where it was two sisters, and they were kind of going back and forth, and then
some people get really physical.
She like shook her, so like her voice warbled. But it was like clearly that was meant to be a bit. You know.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think they would try to create like a sketch around it that would lead into the bird call when I was going to school, but like it was pretty ham-handed at best.
Okay.
And I think we would vote, but I don't know if we ever got like the actual sound of the bird. Like they would do research, and I guess they had some sort of bank of bird sounds. Maybe that was like in a glass case in the library or something like that. But yeah, they would do that at my high school, and I do.
That's cool.
I don't have any regrets in comedy, but I do regret not doing that to try to get on Letterman.
Okay, here's my question. Can we find that bird call online right now?
The Storm Petrel?
Yeah. I want to see if she got it right.
I think it's like the thing though with like people who want to be on reality TV and stuff like that too. It's like if they pick up a semblance of like you want to be an actor or something, then I think they're like a little less like reticent to put you on. Like if they want people who are like, no, we want you to do your bird call.
Yeah.
And like without any sort of like,
just be your unhinged self.
Ulterior motives. Yeah.
This is the real deal.
Nothing like it.
I was gonna say
nothing like it.
Not
at
even
all.
Pretty remotely good. Close.
It doesn't have the car alarm part where she's going.
Yeah, she's like, you know, when somebody's just doing
the internet dial up part.
She's like doing an impression of someone doing an impression of a bird.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd never heard a bird that went, aruga.
I never heard a bird do the Wilhelm scream.
let's get into these questions for you. Stuart Thompson, first question about your hometown. What was the incident?
Well, I'm sure there were many incidents that happened in Piedmont, but the incident that affected people my age was, so my Piedmont's a very small town. It's like maybe 11,000 people. Mm-hmm. And about half of those people are like elderly retirees. So the other half are people with families that are trying to put their kids through this well-funded school. And the middle school and the high school are right next to each other in the center of town. And the high school had a history of having off-campus lunch because it was kind of felt like a Leave It to Beaver town. So you could, you know, there weren't a lot of places to go, and most people didn't have a car, and the lunch was so short, it'd be hard to go off campus really and go far.
Right, because the town doesn't have a grocery store and all that shit.
Well, yeah, I mean, you could go to what was then called Bonfire Market, and they had, assorted candies and maybe a sandwich. But but the middle school, when I was in sixth grade, also had off-campus lunch. Which meant as an 11-year-old, you could just leave at lunch and hopefully come back for the next class.
Where could you walk to?
I don't know. I mean, like, it's
the woods.
It's a hilly town. Yeah. So, like, I had a friend whose family home was within walking distance of school, to the point where you could conceivably walk to his house, have lunch, and come back. But off-campus lunch was quickly canceled while I was in sixth grade because some seventh graders got caught in Piedmont Park smoking pot.
Oh,
so, I was going to say, that's just perfect time to get addicted to cigarettes something for a young for kid.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, you know, there were so many people at my school who smoked pot, and like underage drinking was such a huge issue because like my school was super competitive academically. Like the schools kind of pride themselves, the high school prides itself on, you know, having
bird
like
calls,
not just bird calls, but like a 98% matriculation rate. And everyone who goes to college is going to a college that you've heard of.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. And so everyone is feeling just this deep-seated, unreasonable level of stress, which I've only really come to understand in the last like 5 to 7 years.
Sure.
And then when I talk to people that I went to school with, it's like, hey, were we going through like a real meat grinder? And they're like, yeah. There's some real like PTSD that people are experiencing.
And unpacking it in therapy in their 30s and stuff.
Pretty much. Yeah. And so
did you have the thing where you got to college and you were like, this is fucking it?
You mean like high school was way too crazy?
Because that happened.
And college was a big let off.
Yeah, I mean, I went to like a state school or whatever, but when I got there, that was my first thought, was there was like kids who'd never written an essay, just like basic shit. Where I was like, wait, so I kind of, with the exception of like math, which I'm terrible at, I got to just kind of chill through all the core stuff the first couple of years because my high school was so fucking hard.
I wouldn't be surprised if some people that I went to there that I went to high school with had that experience at their college, but I went to UC Berkeley where everyone's a valedictorian.
Sure, yeah.
So
yeah.
Like that place kicked my ass.
Yeah, I bet.
And no one cared about you struggling. You had to figure it out because there's 26,000 undergrads and there's thousands more waiting for someone to drop out
to
fill that spot.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So no one really cared that anyone was struggling. It's like, hey, this is the big pool.
Yeah.
Learn how to swim.
That's what happened to Ted Kaczynski.
Right.
Cracked at UC Berkeley.
Yeah.
Berkeley broke him.
Dearly beloved alum. Yeah.
Go Bruins, baby. Go Bruins.
That's UCLA. It's go Bears.
Oh, Bears. Whatever.
Ooh.
I don't know from sports. I just know from Unabomb.
Yeah. Yeah. We.
Real sports.
Me no Unabomb.
I mean no Unabomb.
Me like mountain.
At Cal, our when we would play UCLA, our chant was, what's a Bruin anyway? Small dickless bear.
What?
Yeah, it wasn't rooted in much logic, but but anyway, so yeah, that was the big incident. Was that from my recollection and my experience of Piedmont was, you know, oh my god, kids are smoking pot.
Yeah, right, right.
Let's cancel middle school off campus lunch.
So unfair.
In retrospect, it's like ludicrous that anyone thought that it was a good idea.
Oh yeah,
right.
In my high school, they had an assembly because it used to be people to just do whatever they wanted during lunch, but they had to be on campus. So a lot of kids just like hung out in the courtyard or whatever. And they had to have an assembly. And basically they were saying, you can either go to the library or you can go to the cafeteria. You cannot hang out in between. You
can't just loiter.
Yeah. Right. Which it's like, yo, this is a dictatorship. You could just say that. But the senior advisor who said it started the speech off by being like, well, guys, look, in this post 9/11 world, and then announced that you couldn't hang out in the courtyard anymore. And I was like, okay, yeah, I don't know.
Pretty sure Al Qaeda is not targeting Alabama high schools.
No.
Oh, mine thought that too.
Question two, local legend.
Local legends. I mean, there's two really big notable alums of Piedmont, or people who went to Piedmont High. One was John McNamara, who was Secretary of State under President Kennedy.
Yeah, Fog of War.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also a Cal grad.
Yeah,
and
Robert McNamara,
excuse me, sorry. Shows how much I research that. McNamara.
Hey, I'm just an Errol Morris head. You know.
So, and Clint Eastwood went to my high school for a year.
I'm sorry, what? Really? Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah. So you could argue the other incident that happened at my school was Clint Eastwood drove a motorcycle through our breezeway.
Wait, when he was in school or
when
just
when he was in school?
Not like when he was filming Bridges of Madison County.
He's so much funnier now.
Yeah.
Suck it, high school.
Yeah, he did it just to celebrate the end of filming Gran Torino.
Yeah.
Where's an empty chair?
Yeah.
Where are all the white people here?
Yeah, there are too many Asian people for that to be okay now.
Yeah. God damn. Question three. Worst
bar. You might have said this already because there's no damn bars, are there?
Yeah, there's no bar in the city limits of Piedmont, but the big hangout for a lot of people that I went to school with after graduating were there's two bars on Piedmont Avenue, which, like I said, is in Oakland. One of them was called King's Cross, and now it's called the Kona Club. And the other one is called Cato's Ale House. And I've never actually been to the Kona Club because I know that's where everyone I went to high school with that I don't need to see.
They're all there
will
every day.
Go yeah. when I'm back for holidays.
For sure.
And it's like it's just there's and I remember I went with a high school classmate. She wanted to go to Cato's and I said, why do you want to go to Cato's? Like, well, some of our friends from high school are there. I'm like, yeah, but why are we going? It's like, you really want to see these people.
Yeah.
And it's fine. It's like, I mean, the people that I want to see, I actively seek out.
Sure.
But like most of the people that are willing to go to those places are the places that I don't want to go.
It's a lot of explanations. Like, you make money doing that?
Yeah. I mean, that's why I did not go to my, like, I guess the 15-year college or high school graduation I would have that just passed for me. But I mean, I
haven't been to any of them.
Yeah. I mean, I just don't want to explain what I'm doing until I have some like something that's very tangible. I mean, I suppose I could say like, hey, I have a special on YouTube and people understand that now.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
you want to go big dick 'em?
I want a DVD copy.
Oh, what am I doing? You've probably seen it on Hulu.
Yeah, right. No, I mean, it's like I just don't feel like explaining myself to, like, if people want to know about what I'm doing, they can hear about me on podcasts like Fine One, or they can reach out to me directly. I don't need to go to a high school reunion where someone like rented a Corvette to like look nice.
Well, can you can you go to like promote this podcast, maybe?
I plan on doing that at the 30th.
Yeah.
And just hearing about people's kids, hey guys, their work.
I don't want to talk.
My baby
to you.
Is goods from the woods.
It's like, here's a sticker. Here's a sticker. Here's a sticker.
Baby goods.
If you want to know what's going on with me, look me up.
Yeah.
Just walk away.
Yeah. IMDb.
Yeah. We'll see where we are at the 20th.
Okay. Question number four. Best local food.
Best local food. I mean, the Bay Area is run by restaurants.
And sure.
Anything you want to eat, you can find it there in some way, shape, or form. And it's from Burmese food to Italian food to, you know, West African and Ethiopian cuisine. You can find, like, there's even good barbecue in the Bay Area. And so, I mean, one of the places that I've enjoyed that I think you guys might dig is a place called Everett and Jones. It's incredible barbecue. There's one in Jack London Square.
Oh shit.
There's also one on MacArthur, which is another big street in Oakland.
What's the chicken and waffles place in Jack London Square? I've been there before. That place was dope.
Is it something different from Roscoe's, or is it?
No, it's some other chicken and waffle. Anyway, chicken doesn't matter.
Yeah, I don't know
if you knew right off.
Yeah, I mean, like, there's incredible food no matter where you go. You like, that's what the Bay Area kind of prides itself on because it's sometimes it's performatively inclusive, but in reality it is inclusive in a lot of ways. You know, so many different marginalized peoples have come to San Francisco to make it big, you know, from the gold rush to now.
Right.
So, I mean, some of the best Indian food you can have, Thai food, and I mean,
Chinese, I love other Asian food.
Yeah. I mean, all kinds of wonderful food. So, I mean, a list of like, you know, 3 to 5 places that I can think of are Everett and Jones Barbecue, Kanapina, which is an incredible Indian place, Burma Superstar is a great Burmese food place. They have a location in Oakland and one in the Richmond District in San Francisco.
I gotta check out Burmese food.
It's incredible, man. It's a little more herby than like what we might expect with like Chinese food or Thai food. Just really, it's not something that I knew much about, but my girlfriend used to live in San Francisco and she turned me on to it, and it's really tremendous stuff.
There's one near here.
The Burmese spot?
I want to check that place out. There's one in Silver Lake, right?
I mean, it's like very close to here.
Oh, wonderful.
Like around
wonderful.
The damn corner.
The hot pot place?
Us, but
the hot pot place?
No, it's like a newer restaurant.
Oh, okay.
It's Burmese, straight up Burmese food.
Oh, cool. Yeah, it might be worth checking out. I think that, I just don't know. There might not be as big a Burmese population here in Southern California as there is in the Bay Area, but But yeah, you can. You really can't go wrong there. And North Beach is one of the best places to get Italian food on the West Coast.
Stinkin' Rose, man.
Yeah, Stinkin' Rose. There's like the big name spots. I mean, where the Purple Onion was, which is a historic comedy location where Zach Galifianakis did his special there. And this place where Richard Pryor would perform, and Phyllis Diller had a long running show there. That was under an Italian restaurant called Cafe Macaroni. But all along Columbus Avenue, there's incredible food to enjoy. And the Mission District is incredible for Mexican food.
Yeah.
For sure.
Hell yeah. Question five, local ghosts or monsters?
I was struggling to figure out what the local ghost or monster story was, but I did like a cursory amount of research, and there is a huge hotel in Oakland just over the hill from Piedmont on your way into the UC Berkeley campus called the Claremont Hotel.
Yeah. So I lived in Berkeley really briefly.
Oh, really? Okay.
On Bienvenue, very close to the Claremont Hotel. Yeah.
Yeah. So the Claremont Hotel is this big white hotel. I mean, it kind of, from a distance, it kind of looks like the hotel from The Shining.
Yes. A little bit. It's fucking terrifying.
Yeah. And it's where like the my college's football team would stay before games. And I learned that many, many years ago, it burnt down. And people, even though they've completely redone the building and it looks, you know, spotless now, people can still smell that burning smell in their rooms, even when no fire's happening. And they say that, you know, some of the attributions to that smell being permeated is, you know, a haunting from this, the ghost of the 6-year-old girl who died in that fire. Mm-hmm. And she stayed in room 422. And so the fourth floor of that hotel is considered like the haunted floor.
Ooh, we gotta go.
Hell yeah. Yeah. Hey, I walked by it a lot because I used to walk before. Oh, yeah. I didn't have a job at the time, so I had nothing but time to walk down to the campus and stuff like that. Yeah. Walk past that many times before I decided to move to LA instead of make an attempt to live in the East Bay. Last question here. Favorite thing that's not there anymore?
Piedmont is one of those towns that really doesn't change a whole lot.
Yeah, the Jack London's house is still there.
Yeah, I mean, like people kind of like things a certain way. And I mean, I have a lot of gripes with like how the city of Piedmont is run and how and the attitudes that are born from a secluded town like that. Mm. You know, you could call it like a wealthy ghetto, essentially, where people just kind of like seclude themselves and their money and they and live in fear.
Yeah.
I mean, there was one dude, you know, this is not like something I like missed that wasn't there, but this was a weird thing that happened that I think was a step in the right direction, but was not received very well. Was this guy who lived around the corner from where my parents live. This made, I think, this either the Chronicle or New York Times, something like that. He had like this huge house and he had a guest house and he met this homeless couple. Mm-hmm. And he said, "Hey, do you want to stay in my guest house? Like, you guys look like you need some help. I have the ability to help. Why don't you stay in my guest house?" And like,
that's gonna cause an issue.
Yeah, I mean, for a while it worked.
The fucking bee goat guys just rolling up on your shit.
For a while, it was like kind of working. Like, they seemed to have some cohesion. I didn't really have much insight as to like how they got along,
right?
Because you know, the sort of unhoused situation is like so complex, and I don't claim to have any answers about it, but you know, there's a lot of people struggling with mental illness and addiction, and those are things that are hard for any one person to solve.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it requires a willingness to make changes, and you know, some people just get kind of used to living that way, and I don't, you know, and some people just want to live off the grid.
Well, and a lot of times the systems that are in place to kind of help people out are almost carceral in nature, where they don't let you bring your shit inside. They don't let you have a dog. They don't let you, you know, whatever it is.
Yeah, it's real. It makes it hard for people to make those adjustments to not living outside. And so I don't know how they got along, but his neighbors flipped the fuck out when they learned about what this thing that he was doing that seemed pretty decent.
Pretty altruistic.
Yeah. It's great. Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say, I mean, the people that I'm, or what I miss from Piedmont is really just people.
Yeah.
You know, the people that I grew up with that I don't get to see that often.
Yeah, for sure.
Are the people, are what I miss the most.
Unless they're at Cato's Ale House.
Right. Yeah, if they decide going to Cato's or the Kona Club is a good idea, then they are written off. Out of the will.
Out of the will.
Yeah. Very generous. I put my friends in my will.
That's very generous.
You don't leave them a lot, but they're, yeah.
They get a piece of the pie for sure.
Two jelly beans.
Yeah, two jelly beans. Right. And a quarter cup of limeade.
Hell yeah. Well, that is a tour of Stuart Thompson's Piedmont, California. Y'all, we have time for just one more segment, our Jam of the Week. Yeah, this is fucking Electric Light Orchestra, Jeff Lynne and Co.
So badass.
With their song Evil Woman. This, of course, comes off of their 1975 album, Face the Music.
I love when we pick a good song that is going to get some batshit comments.
Oh, you think a song called Evil Woman might get some some weird stuff going on?
I mean, I bet Black Magic Woman would too.
Oh, we've done that. It did. Yeah. This song.
Before you start, I once met somebody who, when they were younger, thought the song was Medieval Woman.
They might have commented on this.
And once you know that, it's hard to unhear it in your head.
Yeah. You are a queen fighting for the kingdom. Medieval woman.
One song that I messed up the lyrics of was I thought Lady Gaga's Paparazzi was Baba Black Sheep.
That'd be a good one too.
I can't unhear that now. Yeah.
This song has 12 million views, 2,453 comments, and y'all, I read every goddamn last one of them. So let us get into the comments real quick. First of all, I'll just get these out of the way and in a quick line. Denver Chamberlain 1 month ago. This is for you, Pamela Hogan Chamberlain. Dennis Gregory 1 month ago. I dedicate this song to Judith Lisa McGonigal. You were so wrong for the way you left and never returned. Anthony Rodriguez 2 months ago. This song was made for my ex, Angela B. Renateria. Go to hell. Michael YK 4 months ago. The bitch Amber DeWald is like that. October 1st.
This is what Jeff Lynne wants. Yeah. This is what he wants.
Wanted to create an army of vengeful men.
An army of incels to gather around this song.
Steve Hill 6 months ago. To Caroline, the witch, and her flying monkeys. You stole from me. May you continue to fuck up the National Health Service with your fraudulent activity. There was also lots of references to AOC and Hillary Clinton, as you might imagine.
Okay. I want to contact a lot of these women and be like, what's your side of the story?
Yeah.
I believe you already.
Oh, he was.
So I wanted to just hear what you have to say.
Yeah, Steve, I'm on your side.
So now that we got those out of the way, let's get down in these comments. Rick's poems from 1 year ago. Takes two to be
I
evil.
I love Rick's poems. I know. No.
Rick's poems.
So good.
They've started taking on a bit of a dark energy that's kind of upsetting.
Have you gotten his coffee table book?
He says, takes two to be evil. One to be. One to destroy. The other one, look upon it. Uh-huh. That's right. I am the evil to evildoers.
I got to shell out.
I was like, Rick, yeah, say, you're scaring us.
You can get on his website. His poetry book, Bitches Are Liars.
Yeah. this guy.
Definitely mentally well person.
Nathan Byberg from 4 years ago. This ELO song never gets old. Song fits my most recent girlfriend perfectly. I'll be enjoying the hell out of this song next week since it's my ex-girlfriend's birthday. She is an evil woman who had done me wrong. She is not only an evil woman, she's a traitorous woman as well. Now I think she has the blues because she doesn't have me to use anymore. I know I'll find a new love someday and I'll do much better. Great stuff.
It's always good when you're celebrating your ex-girlfriend's birthday.
That was better poetry than Rick's poem.
I was going to say, totally.
Rick could look...
really take a page out of this guy's book.
Right. Also, I like that he called her traitorous. Like,
yeah, not treacherous. Yeah, traitorous.
Traitorous. Like,
traitor-like.
She sold state secrets to our foreign enemies.
Yeah, he was dating Edward Snowden.
Yeah. Yeah. Space Force Al from 1 year ago. Vengeance feels good.
Good on the skin.
I have my face locked down in a grin. Third Eye Blind sings songs about me.
Oh, no.
It's like, this isn't Third Eye Blind. This is ELO.
Yeah, hey, yeah, wrong band.
Hey, they should not have been spying on my life. Would you not consider that evil? Would you not consider that evil? Okay.
You got to have Sam Elliott read these comments.
Yeah, yeah.
Would you not consider that evil?
Yeah, yeah.
Would you not?
Evil. Sounds like my bitch of an ex-wife.
Evil. It's what's for my wife.
She took my heart.
And to me, the funny part to me is when I hear this song, I'm like, this is a pretty upbeat, fun song.
I know, right?
It's a jam.
I don't think, like, man, these fucking exes of mine.
I mean, you know, look, Charles Manson loved the Beatles.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Destroy the Liberal Machine number 861.
Okay. That's how many. Wait, there's 860 other Destroy the Liberal Machine?
Yes, I think that's the amount. That one's taken a lot.
Yeah,
yeah, I'm sure.
The accounts he's had banned before this one.
This is from this is from 8 months ago. My wife cheated on me. This will be the song she receives if she fucks up again. No talk.
Well, it appears I've received a song.
He says, no talk, no warning. She'll just come home after receiving the song on phone, and I won't be there. She is now on her last chance.
So you took back your cheating wife, and now you listen to this song and get pissed about it, and then plan for the future where she cheats again.
Yeah, this guy's manifesting in the worst way.
Yeah. Then she comes home, that song's playing on an open laptop, and she just closes the laptop. Doesn't think of anything about
her boyfriend.
I think we're going to go fuck Daryl again.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, great, he's not home. Yeah, we can fucking end in the bed now.
Yeah. Deborah Colley, 2 months ago, I was just called evil by my son. That's terrible, Deborah.
Deborah, if you need to call in.
I want
to
know his story. You know, just like the ex-girlfriends. I want to know the son's
100% story. Video games were taken.
You're an evil woman, mama.
Yeah, yeah. Babies and Milk Forever from 8 months ago.
I can't tell if these are the caption or the name of the person.
They kind of start blending, yeah.
Yeah, Tim said Babies and Milk Forever, but Babies and Milk Forever said this. It's confusing.
Just imagine a woman succeeding in lying to a young man.
Just imagine.
And he thought it was the truth.
Imagine there's no heaven.
And he thought he did something by mistake. My goodness, that's a mess to explain. Especially when the poor boy finds out. That old chestnut. It's a big
really
old,
said that old chase, literally. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a big old net catch. Let's talk about the deadliest catch.
This is a vintage motherfucker. Yeah, like the whole, like, my goodness. That'll throw him for a loop.
Got a few more here. Joseph Widener from 2 years ago. I have this LP. Evil Woman was my theme song when my divorce was finalized in 76. She didn't want me to have any enemies, so she just fucked all my friends. What a gal. Great song.
Great song. Makes
good
me
times.
Mad.
Great oldies.
What a gal.
Cool 104.3.
Great song, though.
Great song reminds me of all my friends getting my ex-wife pregnant one after the other.
The Potato Master from 4 months ago. There were some good names.
Wait a minute. There were some that's a product that I own that is very
helpful. Oh, that's
helpful.
Like a peeler?
Yeah.
He says, a single glimpse into my mind would make most simple-minded people insane.
Into the Potato Master's mind?
Yeah. I just made dark, really fucked up version of a woman.
Oh.
What?
This is like... This sounds like the first conspiracy theorist.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Like that man just figured out how to write like the whole what all of 1990 was trying to
come inside my mind. You won't like what you find.
Encapsulates like every insane clown posse song ever.
Yeah.
If you knew what was happening inside my brain
in my twisted world perspective,
you'd be scared, bro.
Flip your fucking wig to the dark carnival, bro.
You'd be scared.
And our final one here, this is Arletta Sloan from 2 months ago. When I was a kid, I would hear people talking about this song and they couldn't believe that they were saying evil woman. They were trying to figure out what they were really saying. Remember, now this is people hearing it on the radio. They didn't own the album.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I told them that I'm pretty sure it's evil woman because that's what the DJ said. But it does sound like medieval woman to me. Now, why don't they just freak out on a kid? Oh, wait, they did. They all told me I was stupid. I'm stupid as hell, apparently. Why would anyone call a woman medieval? I reminded them that medieval times were both old-fashioned and also something referenced when people were really mad and they'd say, I'm about to go medieval on your ass. So to this day, I still sing medieval woman. And if anyone ever calls me stupid for it again, I will go medieval.
Wow. Yeah, you tell Marlita.
Oh, hell yeah. Fuck yeah. That is.
Put someone in an Iron Maiden.
Great jam.
Good to hold a grudge.
Great Ren Faire tune.
That is the Electric Light Orchestra.
Yeah, why isn't this song on Game of Thrones?
That is the Electric Light Orchestra. Evil Woman, our jam of the week. Stuart Thompson, where can people find you and your wonderful special on the internet?
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, my special's on YouTube. It's Stuart B. Thompson, Conditional Love. They can also find it at my website, stuartthompsoncomedy.com. And Stuart B. Thompson is my handle on every social media site.
Hell yeah. Give Stuart a follow. Fucking
Stuart's
hilarious,
funniest guy. Please the funniest guy.
And thank you, man. And if you like the special, tell a friend.
Yes. Yeah, definitely. Carter, where can people find you online?
Carter_Glasscock on Instagram, but I'm going to expand. I'm going to expand.
This hermit crab's going to a new shell.
I'll tell you what, this baby's going to grow some wings.
Oh, and that's a scary hermit crab.
Yeah. You might. I don't know. Who knows? Maybe I'll get a little frisky with it. Maybe I'll
go into Truth Social, folks.
Yeah, that's right. Get ready, Threads. I don't know. Get ready for my once every 2 months post on Instagram because it's coming.
Hell yeah. Sam, where can people find you on the internet?
They can find me on Twitter. That old chestnut, as I call it. Slam harder, or you could find me on Instagram, samharder666, or on YouTube, LA Comedy Life.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Rivers Langley. And if you would like to watch this broadcast, go to patreon.com/thegoodspod. That is the best way to support this show. Second best way to support this show, head to Apple Podcasts, rate, review, and subscribe. Show the attitude of gratitude. Because if you do not have the attitude of gratitude, Daddy, your kids will be disappointed at a Oompa Loompa.
The Goods from the Woods was recorded and edited by me, Rivers Langley. You can find our show on Twitter at The Goods Pod. Our theme song was composed by Jonas the Space Cowboy.
This was a Brain Freeze podcast.